Hey, what's up, guys? We are back here with the Airgun Experience. We got a fun little show. I'm joined, as usual, with Abby Casey.
What's up, guys?
You can find it AC Outdoors. Super fun. This girl's a wicked wood carver, by the way. I just want to mention that. Make sure you check it out because not only is she a huntress, she's a wood carver.
A huntress.
We also have our man, Justin Jacobson from Utah Airguns.
How's it going?
Good, man. How you feeling?
Doing well.
You're we've got Justin up in his office in a corner. Literally, RMAC starts tomorrow. There's like 900 of like every air gun person you can imagine is downstairs. And we've got him up here in his office doing a podcast and he's freaking out.
No, I'm good. I'm actually preferring it. I'm like, because if I go downstairs, I'm not going to get anything.
Yeah, done.
That's true.
This is the last time we're going to see you.
And yeah, that's what disappear. I mean. I'm like, no, let's get this done because I don't even know where I'll be going after this. So
we're saving you.
Yeah, it's a nice moment right now because during the rest of the event, he's a fleeting view.
Yeah, it's true. You only see his back. Remember, just
there he goes again.
Well, we've got a great episode for today. We are joined by the legendary reality star, the one and only Tun Jones. Tun. The only person I know with tattoos on all of his heads. So, Tun. Question for you. For people who don't know, maybe there's some air gun people out there listening for the first time. Maybe there's people out there that know you from some of your other reality shows and other businesses you've done. Who is Tun Jones from the beginning? How should people know him? Where did you get your entertainment start?
I actually started when I was 16 years old, removing venomous snakes and exotic wildlife from film sets.
And that does not surprise me one bit.
No.
Didn't even know it was a job.
That's weird. No, I actually got caught snake hunting, chasing wildlife and doing photography of wildlife on a film set. And I didn't know I was on the film set till law enforcement showed up and asked me what I was doing. And it was a Van Damme shoot. And I said, I'm collecting venomous snakes. And the executive producer crapped golden Twinkies and said, there's venomous snakes here on the lot.
Yes.
In the desert. They're in the back of my El Camino.
In my El Camino. All of this is making total sense. And so far, not surprised yet.
Yeah. None of this. And they, instead of pressing charges, asked if I would work the film set removing the snakes. And I was ecstatic. I was really happy. And they paid me really well and fed me, surprising, to hang out for 2 weeks and remove venomous snakes from where they were filming.
That's awesome.
Which is pretty cool because they're basically referring to you as disposable.
Yeah. They're like, if he gets bit, we'll just leave him where we found him, in the middle of the desert. We're good. So, and during that film shoot, one of the stuntmen did not show up to work. And they asked if Van Damme could shoot me and throw me through a window.
Shut the front door. What?
Yeah.
What movie?
Desert Heat.
Okay.
It was.
I remember that movie. Yeah.
I died 4 times in that movie.
Did you really?
Yes. And each time I got to get up and go eat and watch them like mourn over my death. I was like, yeah.
That is pretty cool. I did not know this story.
Danny Trejo. Van Damme and a bunch of other people, and the casting director thought I was such a unique character that they 2 weeks later put me in a San Miguel beer commercial, started doing music videos. People would ask me to bring venomous snakes to film sets, and it just snowballed from there.
And now you're an air gun.
Wait a minute. What does a 16-year-old Tun Jones look like?
Not much different. I'll send you a picture.
Really?
Yeah.
Let's take a look at the picture. Because there it is.
Bam.
So because, I mean, right. So you've always had an eclectic look to you. Kind of like that's kind of like scary. If you see me in an alley, I'm definitely going to stab you and take your arms.
Stab?
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Ladies
right.
Gentlemen.
That's a, what is that? A 6-inch.
What's your problem?
How many knives do you have on you?
You don't want to ask that question.
Oh, Justin, everyone's going to play. I love it. Wait a minute. Is that a, this is, what is this, a 6-inch lock blade? That's what, 12 inches total?
It's a utility knife.
Utility knife.
I saw him shaving his side of his face with it earlier.
Is that what you do? Is that how you shave your head, is with that blade?
Utility knife. It's for working and doing work.
We're looking at the, for those of you listening to the podcast, we're looking at the biggest lock blade, which is a foldable knife, folds into the handle. It's like 12 inches long total. He just has it in his pocket. Like a pocket knife.
Technique, when he gets on the line, it's an intimidation factor, you know?
Sometimes you gotta.
How do you think I cut everybody else's airline?
Is that, exactly. That's for a random strand on his pants. Just, or like, oh shoot, I've got a stray in my goatee. I should.
Yeah, I gotta trim that up.
Okay, so 16-year-old Tun Jones is still a sight to behold.
Yes, I used to work at a bar when I was younger, and I only got fired when he realized that we held my 21st birthday there 3 years after I was hired. My bad. Sorry.
Got it.
Yeah.
Got born for trouble, this man.
So when did you step into the airgun world? I mean,
I actually started in the airguns about 3-4 years old. We were not allowed to go hunting or shooting with my father and my grandfather until we were able to shoot our Silver Streak, Benjamin. And my grandpa would take a can out at 10 feet, and you had to hit it 3 times in a row. Then he'd move it 5 feet back, 5 feet back. And until we could hit it at 50 feet, 3 times in a row, we were not allowed to go out hunting with him. So they trained us, and we had to be safe. If he caught us not being safe, we started over.
Mm-hmm.
And it was
like that.
Yeah, it's good.
Very, yeah. He said, oh, if you pointed the barrel anywhere but down or up or down range, you started over. And it taught us a lot of discipline. Even though the air rifle was empty, if we were done shooting and we went to pack it up and we were not being safe, we started over. And that's how my grandpa taught me and my brothers how to shoot. And my dad and my grandpa would sit there, and we thought they were just being mean and bullies. But no, they were teaching us how to be safe with the firearm. But we had to start with an air rifle.
Yeah.
They did not want to take us out in the field until we could show proper handling and gun control and be able to hit your target multiple times with an air rifle under stress. Once we were able to get out to about 50 feet with that, my grandpa would take big marshmallows. And he had a stock pond. No, but he would take the marshmallows and throw them out in the stock pond, and as it would float across, you'd take his foot and step on the water and make him bounce, and you'd have to hit one.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that is cool.
Once you were able to do that, you got to go start out with rabbit hunting and then work our way all the way up to deer and elk.
All right, before we dive into your world of hunting, I want to get back to your entertainment career, because a lot of people know you from
Auction Hunter.
Yeah. So just briefly, how'd you get into that? And tell us a little about that show and kind of where that led you.
Well, I did Auction Hunters for 7 years.
Yeah.
And I was working on Man versus Wild at the time. And I got a phone call, and the director said, "Hey, I need to find someone that does these storage shows." I was supposed to be meeting about a survival show, doing survival and preparedness. And he says, "I can't meet with you today. I got to find some idiot to host this auction show." I said, "What kind of auction?" He's like, "I don't know." And I said, "Well, I do storage auctions. Come to the auctions with me tomorrow and pick somebody out." He looked up at me. He's like, "I just found my idiot."
Oh, yeah, that's a sweet story.
That's a sweet.
That is exactly how it went.
Uh oh! Stop touching things.
Dude, jeez,
it's sagging. Don't
move. The microphone.
There we go. So. Yeah. Okay. But we don't move at all.
Oh God.
Everything be all right, child. There we go. Okay.
That's not scary.
Just a little pep talk to the mic.
Yeah, good.
No, but what we end up doing is the auction show, and he said, if it's a complete flop, we will go back and we'll do the survival show. We'll do the preparedness. And I was like, this is a win-win. I'm going to go do storage auctions, and no one's going to be interested in me digging through crap and finding treasures. Then I can go out and go back in the wilderness, do hunting, cooking, do all the fun stuff I really love doing. Two episodes in, he's all, we just hit 4.5 million viewers on our second episode.
Jeez.
Yep. So there goes the hopes of me ever doing this.
But you were actually doing storage auctions in your regular life at the time?
For 9 years before it.
How'd you get into that? I mean, just, that's random.
No, I was repoing cars as a side job.
Oh my gosh.
Shocker.
Just take a board and just throw something at it.
Hey, I want to know what was your best treasure you found in a storage?
Fresno, California. Opened up a storage locker, bought it for $1,500, and there was $98,000 in silver.
That's a good buy.
That's a win.
I feel like even in today's market.
The guy had been hoarding silver and pouring it into reloading bars. And he would stash it in his storage unit. And it was next to a bunch of lead bars, and they all oxidized pretty similar. And no one knew what to do with the reloading unit in Fresno, California. Bought this unit, started chucking these lead bars in. I grabbed a hold of one, and there goes my back. I hit the ground, and I might have peed a little bit. And my back was out. I was like, what the hell is this? Me, being the ultimate genius, grabbed a can of WD-40, sprayed it on, took a rag, wiped it off. Stack, 0.99. I was like, that's a 22 kilo bar of silver. Started loading these bars of silver in.
I love it that you already knew the metric in kilos.
Oh, yeah.
We'll get to that later. Anyway.
He learned that in repo school.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Foreign and domestic. I don't segregate. Dude, we're taking them all. Welcome to my neighborhood. No, but that is the single biggest hit. And I took it down to L.A. to the smelting factory, and I brought this in. The guy's like, tell me you didn't rob a store. I said, why would you say that?
Well.
And Javier was really nice. He picked up a mirror and held it to my face. Point taken.
And you guys don't know this, but I've known you for a couple of years now. Ton is the biggest teddy bear that I know out there. He looks big and scary. He's covered in tattoos. And
I'm tough.
You're a sweetheart.
He is a sweetheart.
It's true. It's a true story. It's a true story.
But if I saw him in an alley, I'd probably run.
Yeah, I've had a few random jobs here and there.
Man, what a story. So how do you end up in the world of air guns?
When we got done filming, I love air guns. That was part of me growing up.
Mm-hmm.
And my father passed away in 2015 while we were at SHOT Show. Not too long after that, my wife said, I'm pregnant. I said, no, what? My father's not going to be there the way my father and grandpa were for me. So I want to do the same thing with my kids. Teach them safety. Teach them the respect for nature, wilderness. And where does it start? It starts with air guns. Take it back to the basic roots that helped me get into the industry I love. And I wanted to do the same thing with my kids. So
I'm so glad you went there. Yeah. Because my mind was going, crap, you gave up on life and decided to start shooting air guns.
This is a much better story. You did it for the kids.
Yeah,
did it for the kids.
It was a better ending than I was seeing it go. So.
Okay, you think that you get out of this industry, you're kind of doing these auction shows, you're obviously doing a lot of other stuff, you're clearly heading into the entertainment industry, you're doing stunt work at that point, right?
I did stunt work, I did survival for Man vs. Wild, animal wrangler for the film industry, I did props, did firearms, did pyrotechnics,
And then life just changes, unfortunately lose your father, which I'm sorry to hear that, I know that's not easy, have the baby and you're like, that's it. I'm getting out of that industry and looking for more of an industry I can work controlled hours. Is that the idea?
Yeah. I spent more time on the road than at my own home in 10 years, me and my friends calculated over the 10 year where I was actually fully engulfed in the film industry. I almost pulled off a solid 6 months at home.
In 10 years?
In 10 years.
Jeez.
Wow.
It's a tough life.
I have filled.
That's rough.
It was between 2000 and 2009. I had to get 4 extensions for my passport book.
Wow. Golly.
Yeah. That's crazy. And you've all have traveled. You know how hard it is to pull up a passport.
Yeah.
Now get 4 extensions for that.
Wow. Oh, crazy.
I mean, it's my own family and my own friends that I grew up with. Like, hey, where are you at? Not home.
Yeah.
And then you get home and you try to cram so much into a little bit of time that it doesn't work. And then you go try to hang out with your friends. I'm on TV now, so you go to a simple restaurant you used to go to when you were a kid, and let me take a picture. Hi, sorry, did I have any food on my face? And it was time to step back a little bit and focus on family.
Yeah.
I got married, had 2 kids, and I'm like, let's go back to being peaceful. And don't get me wrong, the money was outstanding, but the more money you make, the more problems you get.
More money, more problems.
Should write a song about that.
And it's, what's the cost?
Sure.
I mean, I was filming nonstop till I had a mild seizure and stroke. I lost feeling in my face for 4 weeks, and I still had to go to set. Film crews aren't going to wait. No one's going to wait. They're like, well, we're just going to shoot you from this angle.
Would sorry, you call that your Hollywood side?
Yeah, my Hollywood side, the side that doesn't look like road rash. But it
wow, dude.
At what point and at what cost?
You've really been through it, brother.
Yeah. I mean, they literally picked you up from the hospital in Santa Barbara saying, we have to be in set in 30 minutes. Are you good? No. 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 Okay. We're going to shoot you from this angle with a long lens. Oh, great.
Makeup artist,
like, dude,
I can't look at this.
No, they're like, paint and body ain't gonna fix this face.
Oh my gosh, this is hysterical. If you're just tuning in, we're talking with Tun Jones. He's an airgun extraordinaire for those who are airgunners, but for those who don't shoot airguns or know about airguns, Tun is a big personality, been in the entertainment world and that reality show world for a really long time. And we're now getting to dive into this story, and it is better than ever anticipated. I mean, from the beginning.
Guy of the airgun.
The most interesting airgunner in the world.
They're like, so how do you just start out? I said, better grab a seat and grab a beer because it's going to be a long road trip.
Snakes and marshmallows. Let's get started.
Yeah, I was like, right. We could do this.
Yeah.
I'm all, y'all, you asked me, you opened this door.
That's true. That's true. And I'm loving the direction it's going.
So big airgunner now. I guess explain, what do you do in the industry now? Some people may not know.
I am the director of R&D at Air Force Airguns and stepping into the marketing side recently. And I actually go back with Air Force to 2012 when I approached them and I loved their airguns and I wanted something different. So I got together with John McCaslin and developed the Escape. I wanted a survival air rifle.
Okay. And
this was right at the time where I was hoping that the Auction Hunters wasn't going to take off so I can do the survival show. That never panned out, but the Escape air gun did. And I fell in love with the Air Force because I came to John with an idea. And John's like, in John fashion.
Thinks about it.
Dead silence for like an hour.
Yeah.
While he ponders it over.
And check it. And checking your criminal record, I'm sure, at the time. Oh. He's law enforcement.
Luckily, there was not enough paper printed in that machine because it ran out. No. We were driving on the way to go to a hunt, and he just thought about it. It was like this weird, awkward silence. And he looks up to me and goes, I think we can do this.
That was a pretty good John.
That was for those of you who don't know.
Yeah, did he have a toothpick in his mouth? So.
Yep.
Character.
Think we can do it.
Yep. That is John.
Now, and we got back after that trip, and I don't know what he was thinking, but he let me loose in the machine shop. For you that don't know me, that is not a safe idea. At all. I mean, I got loose in there and put together the gun that I wanted as a survival rifle that can be hand pumped, maximum horsepower in a single shot when one shot counts, and that's how we came up with the Escape. And then the relationship snowballed to, hey, we're building a big bore. Prototype tested the Texan, and it got to the point where every time I was not filming, instead of flying home, I flew to Texas and I worked on the big boards. Worked on all the Texans. And when I finally made the decision that I'm going to step away from the film industry for a while, I grabbed my wife. We flew to Texas, bought a house, flew home, had a fire sale at my house, sold everything in 30 days, packed up a trailer, my truck, drove my pregnant wife across country to move to Texas.
Where were you living at the time?
I was up in Mojave Desert, California, up in Victorville.
Oh, gosh.
Welcome to the desert.
Yeah, well, good.
Zero humidity.
Yeah, so. Palm trees. It's really easy. You hop on the 15 right here and get off at Main Street.
Yeah. Get off at Main Street. Exactly.
Yeah. Your wife must be a saint.
She hasn't killed me yet, so she must be. Either that or she's planning my death.
Pretty sure she knows what she signed up for.
Yeah, now.
So now you're shooting. I mean, now you're a hunter. We see you taking all kinds of big game. You do a lot of big game hunts. What's been your favorite big game hunt with the Texan?
Ooh. Oryx.
Yeah.
It was that. There's my favorite and the most exciting. Scimitar horned oryx, because it was the very first animal I took with the Texan.
That's the very first animal Abby took with a Texan.
In Texas.
Yep.
No way.
With the Texan.
Exactly. We had two prototypes, Texan number one and two. I took number two out and took an Oryx with it.
That's awesome.
Thank you, number two.
Yeah. My second one was the most frustrating hunt ever, Audat.
Been,
let's be real.
Been there.
This is not built for speed or agility.
The game version of hunting chuckers.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Ghost those things are like, they're crazy.
I am the most patient hunter because everybody's like, oh, we're going to go get this on foot. Dude, I didn't get this perfect figure by burning calories. I'm not going to burn more calories than I'm going to do consuming this animal.
Sure.
Let's be realistic. I will get that's underneath the shade tree.
Right there, I guess.
Yeah. Underneath the shade tree, conserve energy, sit there, be quiet. And waited. I waited a day and a half. I went back, snuck out, went to sleep, come back, sit there. This odd dad finally came in, took my 308, and I'm like, it's at 200 yards, range finding it. It's coming in, coming in, coming in. Got to about 110. I said, that's close enough to the dirt road trail, the little off-road trail, that I'm not going to have to chase it. My one shot's going to have to count. So I waited 15 minutes while it kind of walked in circles till he posed perfectly for a side shot, squeezed the trigger, and it dropped. And it was less than 4 yards from the off-road trail.
Perfect.
That was the
that's
most.
My head would explode. I would have run after that thing well before.
That's why.
Patience.
Dude, look. Look. How many calories have you burned chasing animals?
Oh, thousands.
I can probably count mine in a single cheeseburger. Check. Mate.
There you have it.
Well, there you go.
There you have it.
And is this why you've transitioned to competitive shooting? I mean, we're here at RMAC. You're shooting this for the second time, right? Last year? First year?
First year. And I, no offense, brother. Love you to death. They said, you're going to go shoot RMAC. I said, I'm a hunter. What am I supposed to do? If the paper's not moving and I can't eat it, why am I shooting it?
Agreed.
I went in with the most frustrated attitude last year until I sat down during the first heat. I shot next to the Reaper, my Greek god, John Bagakis, sexy little bronze baby.
Greek god.
Yes, yeah. He is. Yes, he is.
And okay. I was...
one way to look at it.
Yeah. I felt bad for the guy because, hey, can I fill up now? No. Can I fill up now? Shh, no. How about now? No, I will tell you when. Now? No, shh. Now. I said, have you ever shot before? I said, I hunt all the time. So have you ever shot competition? I said, no. It's like, you might want to load your mags. Oh, good call. So I pestered him the whole time. shot next to him after the first heat. Dude, I'm hooked. This is, Justin made such an amazing event. I had such an amazing first time experience out shooting that now he's screwed. You're stuck with me, brother.
Well, people come from all around the world to come shoot this match. We have people from Africa, Germany.
We got Chile, Sweden,
UK,
Germany.
It's a big deal.
Mexico.
And for those who don't
understand Canada, Texas.
For those who don't understand it, until you get behind the bench, sit down, and nothing in the world matters but what's inside your scope, that target at 100 yards, and the discipline it takes, because they're, oh, you're sitting on a bench. Yeah, there's a thing called wind, and there's a little itty-bitty color that goes. Until you get to that moment where you can actually try it, I didn't understand it until I squeezed that first round off. Now, there's nothing like it. It's a close parallel, and surprisingly enough, shooting bench rest helps me hunting just as much as hunting helps me shoot bench rest. It's a very interesting relationship between the two. Windage, I don't turn turrets.
Yeah.
I went to public school. Don't ask me to count how many clicks I just did.
No, I'm with you on that one.
Well, and if, like Rossi and I's biggest challenge with bench rest is we have to stay focused for 25 targets.
Yeah, the bench and the rest part.
I start getting bored.
Dude, that's where I am telling you.
Like, wait, what was
patience.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
I love it.
One year I tried to start shooting other people's pellets out of the air while there. I was like, maybe I hit a pellet in the air. Like, that looks fun. I got so dadgum bored I could hardly stand it.
You got two people here, Abby and I, that are patient. Two people here that make coffee jealous that they don't. Coffee doesn't even have this much energy. I'm like, dude, I burn calories watching these two move. I'm like, man, I'm exhausted.
I've watched Abby stand straight up in her little cockeyed stance for like 30 minutes, and the gun never moves. And I'm just like,
yeah, that's called the power of estrogen. I don't have that.
It's
laser focus.
It's amazing.
Yeah, that's the one thing there's no anti-venom for, is that estrogen.
That's true.
It's like, she could just sit there. I'm like, wow, dude.
It's insane.
Fat fatigue's already kicked in. I'm sitting down, y'all.
Are you going to try anything else this year? Are you going to try a little PRS or the speed? Or
I was actually going to, but I had to call Justin. I have not had the time to practice. And there's people out there that practice and practice, and this is something they love. So I had to swallow what little pride I had left and say, hey, Justin, you need to give someone else my spot because I am not going to be prepared. And don't get me wrong, it's going to be fun, but there's a lot of money on the line. And if someone else is going to have that chance, give it to them. Don't be a jerk and suck up that spot because you're going to go experiment.
Man, you're making me feel bad about myself right now.
I was like, when he told me that, I'm like, you're freaking cool, man. Most people, wouldn't give up their spot in RMAC. That's a fact, you know? So,
And I am not prepared and I did not practice, but I do like to shoot things.
Yeah.
I think that wraps it up right there. Like Abby said, this is one of the biggest, nicest, like teddy bear type guys you'll ever meet. Like, you know, what'd you say? A cream filling on the inside?
Under this hard shell's Bavarian cream. I bruise easy.
There you go. Tun Jones, ladies and gentlemen. You guys can find him at Tun Jones Official on all the social media channels. You can go to our website. We'll have links to all that stuff so you can go find out more about Tun. But, dude, what a great story. Thank you for sharing your adventure from, childhood of air guns through the entertainment industry. I'm telling you.
Most interesting air gunner in the world.
Let's tag it. The most interesting air gunner in the world, Tun Jones. We're going to make t-shirts. You can find them at AmericanAirGunner.com. Thanks for listening to the Airgun Experience. There you go. We're not here just to talk about air guns. This is an experience about who air gunners are, what we love, and why we do what we do. So thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.